Welcome to Die Trying.
Stop sniffing my packets.
I'm Patrick Norton.
I'm Michael Ann.
And Michael is interested in personal security.
VPN, tunneling, that's what I want to do and that's what we're going to do.
Oh my goodness. So the internet is comprised of servers and computers and devices and the internet of things and phones and you get the idea, right? And they all send packets to each other through IP routing. So what the idea is with a virtual private network or VPN is that you create an encrypted tunnel between the device you're using, whether it's a computer or your phone or, I don't know, your internet-enabled laundry machine or cat box, and the thing it's connecting to, whether it's a server, like if you're connected to a server to do shopping, or if you're nervous about the people around you in the coffee shop, airport, or hotel that are using the Wi-Fi or internet that's available via Ethernet to your home or office.
Yeah, that's the nice thing about VPN, that you can be on an unsecure network and still be secure.
Yes.
Because all your traffic's going to a place that should be secure.
You may still get hit on the back of the head with a piece of rebar and wake up minus your laptop and your clothes, but your packets up until that point, totally, totally safe.
Maybe. So,
reasonably safe.
I'm gonna show how to do it on an OpenWRT installation or a Gargoyle installation. We showed how to get that running a few months back, really.
It's open source firmware that updates your router, which is really cool because most routers are barely updated more than once from the factory. And in case your router won't support an OpenVPN or you don't wanna run OpenWRT or the idea of running a VPN on your router freaks you out, I'm gonna show you how to run, hopefully, a OpenVPN configuration on your Windows or Linux PC.
To the browser configurations.
To the browser.
Okay, I'm gonna start because I have a feeling my config is gonna be a little bit easier than Patrick's. So I'm here at the Gargoyle router config, and one of the things that we kept on harping on about this was just how easy it was to set things up. And OpenVPN is very much the same way. So I don't know a huge amount about internal submasks and all that. Maybe someone can email in and give us a quick overview of how all that works. But I'm gonna keep pretty much everything here default. I know that the connected clients are gonna have this kind of IP range, which I'm fine with. The one thing I am gonna change down here in the client config is where they're connecting to. The way our network is set up, this IP address is actually behind a firewall, so I don't have access to change to forward to port 1194 or anything like that. But also the way our network is set up, we also have a static IP that we can take, so this is going to be more similar to what you would have at home, that you just find what your IP address is and you want clients to connect to that. I think we'll go a little bit more into dynamic DNS later. So this is the server config. I'm keeping everything the same. In my case, I want to make sure that all traffic is being sent through. And then the client, I'll just add client and then save. The first time you do this, it's gonna say it takes 5 to 10 minutes to generate a cryptographic parameter. I think it's generating just security keys. So you'll have to wait for that. All right, our settings have applied, and now you got this cool download button. You can hit download, and you get a zip file, extract that, and it can be imported onto your client. So I'm gonna drag this to my Android phone, and here's all the configuration keys that you need. So then we can open that up on the OpenVPN app on our Android phone, or if you have TunnelBlick installed on Mac or just any sort of OpenVPN, it usually can read these configuration files. Let's see on Android. All right, so I transferred the configuration file to my phone. I can go ahead and open up this. It'll show the import log and I can hit save. Now, one thing that I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go to the routing and make sure that all traffic is being sent through the phone. So that should be set, and now I can hit connect. Your throughput's gonna very much depend on your network that your phone's connected to, the network that your router is connected to. So now I can see my bit rate. I'm getting 1 kilobit per second, great. Let's see if we can do a speed test here. Restart test. It's actually not too bad. I'm getting about 2.9 megabits, 4 megabits. This is all being routed through the VPN, so my IP address will also be the same as my router config.
So we thought it was going to be fairly simple, right? We were just going to run OpenVPN on a Windows machine behind our network. All you got to do is pass the data from like port 1194 through to that machine. The problem is after, I think between Michael and I, something like 22 hours of experimenting, configuring, and researching, is we couldn't actually get all of the packets, all of the IP data to route through the VPN over Windows.
Maybe someone can send us a link on how to do that, but we had issues with Windows 7 and up of getting the networking and actually sending traffic through there. So we went with pfsense instead.
So pfsense is a free BSD distro that's been hardened and optimized to function as a home router. Well, actually, it's been optimized as a router and firewall. It's pretty badass, pretty configurable, pretty hardcore in terms of protecting your home network from the internet. You're going to need to run it on a standalone machine. I suppose we could have put it in a virtual machine, but that's a little beyond the scope of what we wanted to do for this project. But you're going to need to go to the pfsense.org installation website. It's pretty easy to install. You actually weren't running it as a router or a firewall, though.
No, I was just using this as an OpenVPN box, so it's just on the network, but not all of the network traffic is going through it.
So essentially, you had to make sure you routed the 1194, or in our case, 1195 traffic to the pfSense box.
Yeah, whatever port you're using, make sure that that's being forwarded to the pfSense box.
Cool. And there's a really great article Michael found on highlink.com, highlnk.com, called Configuring OpenVPN on pfSense.
So we'll just kind of walk through what you have to do to get OpenVPN running. And it's a whole pretty similar to the Gargoyle one, actually.
First, you need a certificate. So first thing you're gonna do is add a new certificate authority in the certificate authority manager. Just basically name it. Create a new internal certificate authority, and then you're going to have to turn around and go into the certificate authority manager while you're already there and create some certificates. And your new certificate authority, you're going to sign for this. These are what they call self-signed certificates. So chances are the first time you open them up, whether you're on a OS 10 or Windows laptop or on an Android or iOS device, it's going to panic and tell you that these are self-signed and they're evil and your face is going to be eaten. Ignore those information.
Unless you don't trust yourself.
Yeah, if you don't trust yourself, that's a whole nother problem. But the certificates are pretty easy to generate. You pick a key length, you pick an algorithm, you can give it, the lifetime is the span of days you want it to last. If you're kind of paranoid, or if you work for a small company where you have a lot of employee turnover, you might make those certificate last a week. If you don't really expect to change this configuration around, I particularly like that in the Highlink article they did 3,650 days.
I think that's the default.
Wow. Good to know. Once you get that configured, go into VPN at the top of your pfSense admin page and go into OpenVPN and select Wizards. And this is basically a step-by-step configuration. So, is there an authentication backend you're using? In this case, no. Well, there is, but it's the local user database that pfSense puts together. If you're using LDAP or some other external server, you could choose that. So we're going to use local user access because we created our certificate authority, our certifying authority. Once that's selected, we need to generate a server certificate in our configuration. These settings probably look really familiar. We're going to create a new certificate and select that. Then we need to configure the actual cool parts of the OpenVPN remote access. So
in this case, it defaults to 1194, but I'm going to do 1195 because we had issues with forwarding on our particular router. It'll probably be 1194 for you.
So basically, you're looking at the port, the name, where you're listening for incoming connections, which is kind of a big deal, because if you don't listen at the right place, you're going to be in trouble. So we chose our WAN for that one.
Tunnel network's going to be the IP range that your VPN clients are going to get. In this case, I just kept what the example was.
Probably a wise choice.
And a lot of stuff you can keep blank, and it still works.
What Michael's saying is he did not select a local network or a concurrent connection.
But I did choose compression.
Why?
I don't know, faster.
Assuming your machine is fast enough to do the compression.
And then DNS servers you can set. So I set it to the Google ones. And that's everything I did.
And hit the next button and see if your face explodes.
It'll tell you if you did something wrong. And then you can add rules so that it just punches holes in all the things that you need.
This is a good thing.
Configuration now complete. So now it tells you to make things easier. You can go into packages, and here under available packages, and here there's an OpenVPN client export utility. This makes it easy to generate everything for your clients.
Next thing you need to do to make this function is to add a client. You're going to create a client for each individual person or device you want to connect.
Let's add a Patrick.
Tekzilla. Now everyone knows my password.
You can be an admin.
Thank you.
And then we're going to click Create User Certificate.
That's kind of important. We'll explain why in a moment.
Patrick. Save. Cool, now it shows up in there.
Now we need to go to the client export utility, which takes your client information and the certificates that you need, bundles them together so you can send them out to people so they can access your OpenVPN. So first thing in there is like, you know, the server information, make sure you've got the right port information in there, and hostname resolution. You could, if you want to, type in like your static IP address, 3.3.72.114, whatever that information happens to be, or do yourself a favor, go to our sponsor, domain.com, buy a domain name, use the coupon code Tekzilla, you'll get 20% off that domain name, which is a really fat deal, and then enter in that domain name, and you will be able to basically type lovely words and letters instead of dotted quads.
Yeah, so you can point that domain name to your static IP, and then if you ever change it for some reason or change the server location, you can keep all of your client configs the same.
Which is a big deal if you've ever had to redo a whole bunch of client information. So just keep that in mind. Domain.com, use the offer code Tekzilla, support Dytryon, and save yourself some money in the process. So server certificate information, do you leave the random local port checked or unchecked?
I leave it checked because then you can have multiple clients simultaneously.
Certificate options in case you're using some sort of external service for that. You can use a proxy to communicate with the server. We generally keep all of this unchecked.
Then you can come down here and you can see all of these different export options to make your life easier. So I'm using the OpenVPN client, so I can click on this one. It'll be just a single file that you can open up on your app.
Now that you've created the export, you can send that to the client. They can go to openvpn.com, download the appropriate client for their operating system, load up your OPVN file, and they should be good to go to log into your newly minted OpenVPN connection to your pfSense firewall.
Do you feel secure?
Absolutely.
I feel secure. Hopefully you feel secure and you can feel secure and warm and fuzzy and help support Dytryon and making in general by subscribing. Dytryon.com or youtube.com/Dytryon.
And you can also email us, dytryon@revision3.com, or we're on Twitter, Dytryon.
And because we'd like some more of you to hang out at our Reddit, the Dytryon Reddit, or just, you know, I'll tell you what, if you tweet, send us an email, dytryon@revision3.com, or post in the Reddit forum, you may, one of you randomly, will get a custom hand-assembled and manufactured, well, hand-printed t-shirt by Michael and I, sent to you in the size of your choice.
I think I'm just gonna cut the sleeves off of a shirt that we have already. Does that work?
Classy, Michael. Classy. Thanks so much for watching this episode of Dytryon. I'm Patrick Norton.
I'm Michael Hand.
We'll see you next week. Welcome to Dytryon.
Stop sniffing my packets.
I'm Patrick Norton.
I'm Michael Hand.
And I have not been sniffing Michael's packets. However, the...